Secretary, Ministry of Commerce, Government of the People's Republics of Bangladesh as Chief Guest, and Mr. Bijoy Bhattacharji, Vice Chairman, Export Promotion Bureau, EPB, as Special Guest. We have Mr. Humayun Rashid, Director DCCI and Managing Director and CEO, EnergyPack Power Generation Limited, Dr. Mustafa Abid Khan, Member, Bangladesh Tariff Commission, and Dr. M. Mashrur Riyaj, Senior Economist and Program Manager, International Finance Corporation, IFC, World Bank Group, as panel discussants of this seminar. The keynote paper will be presented by Mr. Ali Ahmed, CEO, BFTI. Also present here today, Mr. Kamrul Islam FCS, Senior Vice President DCCI, Mr. Riyad Hussain, Vice President DCCI, Distinguished Directors DCCI, as well as Mr. AHM Rezaul Kobir, Secretary General DCCI. Ladies and gentlemen, at the very outset, may I request Hafiz Qari Muhammad Abdus Sattar to recite a few verses from the Holy Quran.
Assalamu alaikum. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إنا أعطيناك الكوثر فصلي لربك وانحر إن شانئك هو الأبتر صدق الله العظيم.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, now I would like to request Mr. Abul Kashim Khan, President DCCI, to kindly present crest to our chief guest, Mr. Shubhashish Bose, Senior Secretary, Ministry of Commerce, Gov. Ladies and gentlemen, now I would like to request Mr. Abul Kashim Khan, President DCCI, to kindly present crest to our chief guest, Mr. Shubhashish Bose, Senior Secretary, Ministry of Commerce, Government of the People's Republic of Bangladesh. Now, I would like to request Mr. Abul Kashim Khan, President DCCI, to kindly present crest to our special guest, Mr. Bijoy Bhattacharji, Vice Chairman, Export Promotion Bureau, EPB. Thank you, sirs. Ladies and gentlemen, may I now take the opportunity to request Mr. Abul Kashim Khan, President DCCI, to kindly deliver his welcome address.
Thank you. Bismillah Rahman Rahim, Chief Guest of today's program, Senior Secretary, Ministry of Commerce, Special Guest, Vice Chairman, EPB, CEO of Bangladesh Foreign Trade Institute, BFTI, our co-host for today's program, panel speakers, business leaders, my colleagues from the board, friends from media, ladies and gentlemen, Assalamu alaikum, very good morning to you all. I would like to take this opportunity to welcome you all to today's seminar on trade war and implications for Bangladesh, jointly organized by DCCI and BFTI. This seminar today is indeed an interesting topic given the current trade situation affecting all of us globally. The world has been undergoing a competitive and growing global trade regime, considering the trade is critical enabler among nations. Trade war, the buzzword of today's global affairs, and conditioning tomorrow's impact, ranging from international market system to distant households across the world. Quoting from Alibaba's founder Jack Ma, when trade stops, the war starts. So trade is the way to stop wars. He also termed the trade war is a relic of the 20th century, which could last possibly for the next 20 years. Now, ladies and gentlemen, we are moving from a multilateral trade to a bilateral trading system, it seems. In the latest World Bank Economic Outlook report, the International Monetary IMF put the cost of trade war at $430 billion, 0.5% of world trade of GDP. Another calculation from JP Morgan's Mr. John Normetz predicts that a worst-case scenario due to this trade war could reduce global growth by an amount of nearly 1.4% over the 2 years. There is no doubt that the global supply chain and financial markets are major transmission mechanism that can propagate the shocks across the world. While everyone will suffer, Asia will take the worst hit given its high degree of supply chain integration with Chinese manufacturing assembly operations. Given all these concerns, Singapore's biggest bank, DBS, predicts that a full-scale trade war defined as 15% to 20% tariff on products traded between US and China could impact Singapore's growth rate for the next year from a forecast of 2.7% to a reduced 1.2%. Consequently, Malaysia's growth rate in 2019 could fall by an estimated 5%, from 5% to 3.7%. Ladies and gentlemen, while most experts found trade war is detrimental to the world economy, some countries could still benefit from the Chinese tariff on goods, since China recently announced a long list of tariff cuts imports from South Korea, India, Bangladesh, Laos, and Sri Lanka. So it is an opportune moment while Bangladesh needs to capitalize on the tariff cuts and seize the window of opportunity in case of our leveraging scenario will be the Asia-Pacific Trade Agreement, of which Bangladesh is a member, was signed by China before the entry to the World Trade Organization. Moreover, Bangladesh can be more popular apparel sourcing destination for Western retailers due to the ongoing US-China trade war. And a latest survey by the Asian Inspection, a Hong Kong-based global inspection and accreditation body, according to EPB, the export share of Bangladesh in the US says total RMG export has gone up by 6.46% during the first 9 months of 2018, which was 6.41% in the previous year. However, there are areas which could impact Bangladesh from this trade war. Details will be given in the keynote presenter today, in his keynote paper. Ladies and gentlemen, let me just go through the areas that we think Bangladesh needs to maximize to get the maximum benefit. And these are some of the suggestions that we have come to make in today's seminar, which can be probably debated in the later discussion in the open session. One, Bangladesh is at a disadvantage as most of the Bangladeshi products were subject to US duty and tariff on them equivalent to nearly 15.2%. So we feel that there is room to renegotiate with the US counterpart in the tariffs which are going for Bangladesh. So we think renegotiation of these can open new opportunities for Bangladesh. Two, supply chain relocation. Bangladesh could benefit by taking advantage of the supply chain relocation that's going to happen in the long run if the trade war continues. Already Chinese firms are likely to shift their units from China to other countries. But most of these relocations are taking place in Vietnam, Cambodia, and even in Myanmar. In this connection, we would be equipped enough in competing with these countries. Bangladesh needs to take advantage and start building its logistics and distribution strength for becoming a center for supply chain hub. And therefore, logistics and warehousing should be looked into as a priority and declared as a thrust sector to be created for reducing the lead time for raw materials for our major industries and export items. Three, creating a national port strategy following the Indian innovative model of Sagarmala strategy, where private investors are encouraged to build port and other facilities along with everything else is built by the government for providing from providing concession rates on land lease to dredging. For the smooth development of the greater participation of the private sector, a national maritime and port authority also needs to be created. Such initiative will increase our competitiveness in transport, port and logistics. For investing inviting sunset industry from China and the China Plus One strategy, many sunset industries. And many sunset industries of China will need to move out, and therefore Bangladesh will need to become an ideal destination due to impending trade war as well as rising cost of production. Therefore, Bangladesh has to create a smooth transition process and have built an enabling situation with focus on ease of doing business from such factories to be relocated, and a planned marketing and branding for Bangladesh needs to happen. Campaign needs to be made under an overall strategic plan by the government with the private sector, and the SEZ, special economic zones, will have to become the best option in Bangladesh for these investments. Therefore, connectivity and other capacity building of these SEZ must be under fast track. In addition, port facility and other facilities need to be under a top priority as well. Five, the fourth industrial revolution, 4IR, is kicking in, and therefore we must engage in appropriate R&D support and funding from the government to become more technology and friendly and competitive. There must be short-term, mid-term and long-term strategic direction to address the 4IR advancements, which will become another challenge for Bangladesh if not addressed properly. Six, building collaboration between researchers, academia and industry is critical to product development and product diversification. DCCI is in the process of creating Research and Innovation Bangladesh, popularly known as RNI Bangladesh. This will be the first of its kind where industry and academia will meet to bring industry-centric research. Such initiative will need to be supported and funded by the government, especially the Ministry of Commerce. Seven, enabling private sector and stakeholders in policy design for improving investment climate, policy continuity and improved predictability on business climate and confidence. Business deregulation, financial and tax reform improvements, cost of doing business condition. Currently, Bangladesh is in the 176th position of doing business index by the World Report 2019. And therefore, a high-powered national competitive strategic action task force under the public-private initiative has to be done. Ladies and gentlemen, I take this opportunity to make a reference made by Mr. Mark Mobis, a well-respected American financial industry expert and investor, and I quote, he says, what I would buy now in those countries that are going to be exporting to the US instead of China, like Bangladesh, Turkey and Vietnam. So it is made quite a clear indication that Bangladesh surely is going to be the next destination in terms of both market and investment for many of the developed economies. Now the question is, are we ready to receive this kind of investment? I would like to request the Ministry of Commerce, BIDA, NBR, Tariff Commission and other concerned government agencies and leading chambers of commerce to form this National Competitive Strategic Action Task Force to work on trend, on economic trend, impact on trade, war and determine likely opportunities and challenges and strategic means for visible and positive impact of trade balance resulting greater trade and economic development for Bangladesh in the coming days. Ladies and gentlemen, I believe the valuable insights from our three expert panelists, Dr. Masroor Riaz, senior economist from the World Bank, to provide his thoughts from a global perspective. Then we have Dr. Mustafa Abed Khan, a member from the Bangladesh Tariff Commission, for his thought from a Bangladesh perspective, and then we have Mr. Humayun Rashid, Managing Director of Energy Bank and former SVP of Dhaka Chamber, to give his views from the private sector. And lastly, we have our keynote paper made by Mr. Ali Ahmed, CEO of BFDI, for his detailed analysis on this very important topic facing us. I'm indeed looking forward to everybody's contribution in the open session. Thank you, and Allah Hafiz.
Thank you, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, I would now request Mr. Ali Ahmed, CEO, BFTI, to present his keynote paper.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, respected Chief Guest, Honorable Special Guest, my dear panelists, economists, experts, trade experts, tradespeople, and the other respected specialists, and ladies and gentlemen, and our friends from the media. What the respected chairman has said has covered some of what I would like to say, not all. That is because truth has only one facet, and we have both been preparing to tell the truth, and that truth is not a very good one. I'm not very sure if this is the first presentation or public discussion in Dhaka or in Bangladesh on trade war. So this is a very opportune time and moment for us to understand and to take stock as to where we stand as a country, because Bangladesh, because of our being hedged in by China and India on two sides, we always say we are a small country, but we are not. A country of 163 or 165 million people and about nearly $3 trillion economy, $3 billion economy, $300 billion. We are not a small country. So let us have this courage and understanding and the confidence. With these few words, I would like to go to the slides. A small word. Previously, people used to talk, and that would be more personal interaction, the exchange of ideas, eyes, and all that. But the slides have made it impersonal. But one great advantage is that the records are left, so we can flip through the pages later and see what has been said. So I go on to the slides. We see the title, the trade war, and they have written implications. We knew that these differences are there, but we didn't care, because implications and impacts, more or less the same thing. So we carry on with this. The contents are going to be, contents are background of the trade war, impact on the global, its impact on the global economy, and its impact separately on Bangladesh, and then what next? We have tried to look into the future. First of all, let us know what trade war is. It is not a quotation, it is actually our creation, but it's sort of a design, the marks that you see. Trade war is when countries attack each other's trade with taxes and quotas. This raise in the quotas and taxes expectedly causes the others to respond by imposing counter tariffs and a tit for tat escalation. The result can lead to a decrease in the growth of not only both economies but also the rest of the world, and lead to rising political tensions and also economic bad condition. Now the timeline, let's see how it started here. The president, as I said, it's a 20th, Mr. President said in his speech, it's a 20th century affair, but we have brought it forward to 21st century. First salvos of this war was shot by none other than the chief of staff of the greatest power on earth, the American president, Mr. Donald Trump. It was in March 2018. USA imposed 25% tariff on steel and 10% on aluminium. That was more or less across the board, though he named only a few countries. In my opinion, and in the opinion of trade experts, this is a violation, because if you follow MFN, most favored nation, it has to be on all the countries, but he covered mostly EU, Japan, Korea, and all that, but targeted mainly at China. Then April 2018, China imposed tariffs, retaliatory tariff by China on $3 billion worth of goods products from USA. And then bigger list from USA followed by a $50 billion worth of goods, and then China's counter tariff of US dollars, $50 billion import from the US. Next is August 2018. Trade volume at stake comes to $200 billion. Then September 2018, US threatens tariffs on 267 billion more goods from September 2018. These have not been realized yet. I put in this word, now an APEC session is going on in Papua New Guinea, but there is a projected meeting of the G20 at the end of this month, and I have not written it here, this month and next, where Xi Jinping and Donald Trump are supposed to meet and talk. Let us hope they will come back from the brink, or the world economy, including Bangladesh's, will have a very catastrophic fall in many cases. So the next is the USA logic, why USA thought it should impose. They countering the China, as you know, declared Made in China 2025 policy, and that immediately triggered the US reaction. They felt that China should not be allowed to go. I read an article in The Economist about 2-3 months back, or maybe 6 months back. They said how UK behaved while USA was rising, more or less in the same way. They tried to counter USA in the early 20th century, but couldn't finally. Let's see what happens between China and the USA later. Second is a protection of the intellectual properties of the USA. China, USA says, especially Donald Trump, but there may be some truths, that say they have stolen our intellectual properties, stolen our jobs. And the third is saving American jobs. If your production is shifted, then your jobs are also shifted. So these are the reasons USA provides. And then USA didn't start only with China, they also didn't spare the European Union. So let's see what next. About the European Union, the US has levied tariffs on imports of US steel and aluminium at the same rate of 10 and 25% on aluminium 10 and steel 25%. And then Brussels has retaliated with tariffs on $3.2 billion worth of goods, US goods. Then the EU is trying to prevent the USA from imposing a 20% tariff on cars from the US, from the EU region. Because we know some of the very world famous brands are produced in the EU areas, and they are still negotiating in order to be able to avoid this imposition, because that would be a serious blow to the EU economy. The EU is also preparing counter tariff lists on goods worth $20 billion. Then let's see US Mexico Canada, very interesting. We know during Bill Clinton's time, President Bill Clinton, the NAFTA agreement was negotiated and signed between the three North American free trade agreement between Mexico, Canada, and the US. Donald Trump is on record to have said this is the worst ever trade deal. And he wanted to do away with this, but it was difficult. So they have renegotiated and very recently arrived at a new old wine in a new bottle. They call it now USMCA, United States, Mexico, and Canada Agreement, USMCA. They arrived at it. It is supposed to be in place by 1st of January 2020. It is not in place as yet. Upon imposition of tariffs on steel and aluminium, Canada and Mexico retaliated with counter tariffs. President Trump wished to replace NAFTA with bilateral deals with Canada and Mexico, which both nations initially opposed, but they later came round to the views of the US and they have arrived at some sort of a negotiated settlement. NAFTA is now coming with a new name. It has come with a new name, United States Mexico Canada Agreement. US and Canada is referring USMCA as a modernized agreement that will strengthen the middle class and create good, well-paying jobs. These are all slides, so we are cutting things short. A lot of things to say on this. One great outlook is Canada wanted to save its dairy products export and some other exports. And Mexico's great worry was car. Other foreign companies or American companies having plants they are exporting to US at a cheaper rate. And USA thought to save their jobs, they have now made it one very funny, very funny clause of the new agreement coming in 2020 is that USA can Mexico can export cars to the USA only if it is produced by laborers who are paid not less than $16 an hour. It would be three times more than the present Mexican wage rate. I don't know how it's going to come into practical use. Then let's see its impact on global economy. As you know, it is not a big article, so we are not writing pages. We are just giving snapshots of what we understand. Possible impact of trade war. We have divided in a very small parcels and just made the main moot points. But while open discussion will be there, if you feel like you can ask us questions, and I'm sure our very learned discussants are going to elaborate it further. The global economy, as our Mr. President has already said, loss of 0.81 percentage points of global GDP. The whole global GDP loss would be 0.81%. And then it may reduce merchandise trade volume by $156.5 billion worth of goods and services, maybe. May lead to global recession. That is the worst thing we are afraid of. Global recession is a fear that is coming if we cannot stop this process. And then, about this global thing, we come to the USA. USA, the country that has initiated this thing, is going to face inflation because they are bringing in other products to USA, and USA wage rate is higher than in China, in Mexico, in many other countries. Therefore, cost of production is going to be higher there. And inflation rate has been estimated to be from 0.03 to 0.05% within the next 3 years. Then could negatively affect GDP growth by 0.2 to 0.3% in the US itself. Consumers are the major sufferers, victims, because price will go up. Investment, though he will be forcing some investments, but ultimately his economy will go down, slow down, and recession might follow. And then China of course is going to be affected a little worse than the US now, could cut growth by nearly 2 percentage points over the next 2 years. Then Chinese stock market stock declined more than 20% this year. Then impact may be greatly offset. China is also trying to cushion the impact that is coming, offset by the Chinese government's policies in tax cuts. They have gone for some tax cuts to make production less costly. Then reform in interest rates, and also has opened free trade with some countries, neighboring countries, reduced taxes from imports from some other countries. Now, at a glance, let us see the impact on other countries. We have grouped some countries, not the entire world, of course, but some countries. Taiwan, South Korea, Japan, etc. We know in today's supply chain, many of these countries, or some of these countries named here, supply many of the spare parts and the small things to China, which is assembled and made and then sent to the USA and elsewhere. So if China's export slows down, then this demand from these countries for those spares and other things will also slow down, so they will suffer. Singapore's growth has been estimated might slow down to 1.2% from the estimated 2.7%. So Singapore is going to have a big shock. Malaysia's growth rate in 2019 may fall from estimated 5% to 3.7%, a slowdown there. But may benefit in the low-end technology areas. Malaysia may increase its exports to other countries needing low technology products. Then Vietnam, our great competitor, could be among the short-term gainers. As the respected president has already said in his speech, Vietnam is going to get most of the diverted imports, investments from China, and it's coming from elsewhere also. Now, what about India, our close neighbor? Exports are probably increasing as an indirect effect of trade war. We'll see later, but we can just hint it here, that China has already diverted its cotton import from India and has reduced its duty to India and to other countries. So India is going to be a gainer. Then tariffs in China are getting lower. They're also lowering their tariff rates for these countries. China are importing cotton, as we have said, from India and other Asian countries instead of from the US. So India is going to be benefited. But India is also affected by the steel, aluminium and all those exports. India was also started exporting cars to the US. That is also badly affected. So India is not very happy. It is also now trying to patch up with China and become more friendly. Then what else? Other impacts. What other impacts? Global price of oil. If production slows down, starting with China and then going to the United States and elsewhere in the rest of the world, then oil demand would likely fall, and global oil prices may fall if the Chinese demand for oil falls. Number two is global stock market. We already have seen that Hong Kong's Hang Seng fell by 2.2%, Japan's Nikkei dropped by 1%, Germany's DAX declined by 2%, France's CAC 40 fell by 0.09%. That is the fall in the stock market. Now, let us, the most crucial thing, the impact on Bangladesh. We have divided this impact into three broad categories. And as I said, have just dropped hints in areas. We believe that discussions will increase. These three areas are impact on export, our major concern, but impact on import also, that would be a concern, and another impact on investment, which we need so badly for our development. So these three broad categories. The impact on export, we have broadly said that orders, especially RMG from the USA, what is happening? Many buyers are now coming back to Bangladesh because they foresee, very interestingly, China has, India, USA has not yet imposed any special tariff on Chinese RMG products because they know, they understand that it's going to affect each and every US citizen, so they desisted from doing that. But still, in anticipation that this might also happen, many manufacturers are now coming back to Bangladesh. Growth in the RMG sector, export to USA has increased, but very marginally. Bangladesh share in the USA's total RMG export was 6.46%. It has risen by 2017, 6.41%. No, it has risen to 4.1646 from 4.1%, slight marginal increase. That is mainly because relocations, as he has said, is going mainly to Vietnam, to Cambodia, to Myanmar even, some, but very little to Bangladesh. The shift to the US and EU orders are more to Vietnam, Cambodia, or even to Myanmar than in Bangladesh. Then China lowering tariffs. As we said, in order to be able to counter US shell and bombardment, China has already started removing or lowering tariffs on many goods for Bangladesh, India and Laos and some other countries, as the President has said. We, the Senior Secretary of the Ministry of Commerce is here. We discussed and it was decided China was asking whether we agree to their duty-free and quota-free import of our garment products. Bangladesh government has said in the positive, yes, we would love that. So this is things, how things are happening. Then less competitive price due to depreciation. All the benefits that we would be able to receive has to some extent been offset by China's depreciation of its RMB, RMB or Yuan as they call it. So that is an offsetting factor. Still, our export to China will hopefully increase. The impact on imports. One we have divided it for some categories, and due to price drop, because of price fall of prices, cotton prices dropped by around 10% because of Chinese tariff on American cotton, it has dropped. Soybean prices have also dropped. I was reading the current issue of The Economist has said that there is a huge gap, and very surprisingly, the soybean production this season has risen by 1/3 more than in the previous season. So America is now in a great problem with soybean and sorghum and certain other goods. America, US, China has imposed tariffs on this. So these are going to be cheaper. We might be getting it cheaper. Bangladesh could get advantage as an importer of soybean and cotton. But cotton, our greatest source is, we bought only 20% from the US, the majority from India. But India has now raised its price also, seeing that the demand has grown higher. Then currency depreciation in China, we already have said, because of this depreciation, as you know, if there is depreciation, imports will be cheaper comparatively speaking, so imports will be rising. Surge in import of cheap, the problem is, when the depreciation has been made in China, depreciation in a country means its exports surge. But China has big things, but also some cheap commodities, small, very cheap. So there is a fear that there may be a surge of import of those cheap items to Bangladesh. We have to be careful. Others, rise in price of steel. Globally, there is a rise in price of steel, but it should not have been, in my opinion, I have written elsewhere. Because if US, basically USA, China, EU, India, Canada, Japan, they are all hit by the higher steel tariff. So it should be diverted elsewhere. For Bangladesh, it should be lower. But incidentally, we see that the basic raw material of Bangladeshi steel industry scraps, coming mainly from America, they have shown a rise. I believe this is a temporary affair, but let us see what happens. And cotton, as we have said, India has already raised its price, so we are not greatly benefited. And the next is impact of investment. Decline in global investment, but Bangladesh registered some growth. The global FDI flows fell by 23% in 2017, globally, to $1.43 trillion from $1.87 trillion. It was $1.87 trillion in 2016. It has now become $1.43 trillion in 2017. But the case of Bangladesh, as you can see in the left-hand side, is from 15, 16, 17, 18, it has risen, it has been rising, not very greatly, but it is rising compared to the rest of the world. A relocation of factories, investment, we might get, we are getting some, relocation of factories. There is also a chance of relocation of factories from China. This, however, is a long process, and there would be more relocation in Vietnam, Cambodia, we have said it already. Then expansion of existing business in Bangladesh. Many companies are now expanding their production capacity, we know that. I'm within my time, okay? Then other impacts on in the long run. In the long run, distortion in the global supply chain, as you have said, global supply chain, say Vietnam or even Korea, Japan sending some spares to China, they are assembling and sending it to America. These are being cut off or distorted. And that could raise global cost of production and cost of doing business. That would be harmful for the world economy. Then shift in the consumer's demand. Consumers would be shifting their demands too, naturally, if the prices are going. So that would be also affecting the global supply chain and value chain. Bangladesh's export will also fall because of that. Then the greatest fear is that as a result of these tariffs and counter-tariffs, tit for tat and all those things, this whole thing might lead to a recession, fall in the overall production and employment and everything in the world. That reminds us, who have read about the Great Depression of the 1930s, because that was very dangerous, and even in America, there was literally, there was begging. So I'm afraid they walk away from the brink, and thank you very much, walk away from the brink. Now about Bangladesh, how to materialize the potential benefits. First is analyzing the opportunities. Bangladesh must, the think tanks, the government, the universities, the business associations and business people must sit together and cool-headedly analyze what can be done, what should be done, to understand the potentials that can be utilized. Then embracing, enhancing capacity. Then go for enhancing our capacity in the areas where we will be able to export more, produce more, and be able to capture more portion of the world market. Then attracting investments. This is the crux of the problem we have been talking about for decades now. We need investment. Local investments are coming, but this is not coming in a big way, and this is no solution. We also need investments from multilateral agencies, but mainly from FDIs. But that is the problem. Incentivizing the investors to invest in Bangladesh, easier said than done. Then branding the investment opportunities in Bangladesh. Our investment policy is one of the very best in the world, should be attractive, but what is the problem then? Problem is expediting infrastructure projects. We are now having some infrastructure projects. This should be expedited and completed as soon as we may. And then the greatest problem, it bundles and encompasses many things. The ease of doing business. As Mr. President has said, it has worsened during the last 1 year. So it must improve. Maybe in the way he has suggested, there should be a committee comprising all. Just a government agency may not be enough, as we now have. Then policy level readiness to face the any uncertain situation and sustain the growth. There should be a policy level readiness for that. Where is it all leading to? A global recession? There is a fear. Failure of multilateralism? Multilateralism means WTO in trade. Donald Trump has been threatening to withdraw from the WTO because WTO MFN initially gave China the advantage, so they said he would do it. But incidentally, his commerce secretary, who was in the past was the WTO, has been able to persuade him not to withdraw from it. So within this, let us hope it is retained, because dismantling the WTO, although it has been made greatly dysfunctional by USA by not posting their judges and all those things, and now flagrantly violating it. So this impact that might be still ambiguous, as I referred, the APEC session is going on, but there's a great talk in the press and in the media that in the G20 meeting in Buenos Aires at the end of this month, spilling over to the next, Xi Jinping and Donald Trump are supposed to meet. I do not know what comes out of that meeting, but if they do not decide to walk away from the brink where they are now standing, the world might fall into the great abyss of this recession, and that is not going to be good for Bangladesh, for China, for US, or for anyone in the world. So you would see that although we do not expect much of goodwill from or good sense in Trump, but hope he sees. But he has one sort of, he has a method in his madness. He has taken care of the EU, taken care of the NAFTA, and now he is catching China, he thinks. But China is also not a very easy country to handle for Donald Trump. So let's wait and let's pray, if prayer is of any use, that they walk away from the brink and we have a better time. With these few words, I end my slide presentation with thanks to the chair, to the chief guest, to special guest, to my dear colleagues in the among the discussants, and to the dear audience. Thank you all very much.
Thank you, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, it is now time for panel discussion, and we would like to listen next 7 to 8 minutes from Mr. Humayun Rashid, Director DCCI and Managing Director and CEO, Energy Pack Power Generation Limited.
Good Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, Assalamu Alaikum. Adar bepari hoye jahajer khobor nawa. The days has been changed, really. Today we use imported ginger. Phole jahajer khobor amader nitei hoy. See the changes in the whole world. This trade war is totally touching our heart, body, life, everything. TPP was one of the issues what we believe that President Obama addressed and signed, and that has not been implemented, and that has been cancelled by President Donald Trump. What advantage we got from here? Nothing, not much. Still, Bangladesh export to America is not really increasing, though Bangladesh RMG have very large opportunities exporting to European community, because there is a also non-tariff barrier exporting RMG to USA. One good thing that because of the war, Bangladesh got advantage. One thing, I buy steel, my company buys about 10,000 to 20,000 tons of steels every year. I monitor steel's price every day. I got from last week to this week about $30 price decrease in the steels. I buy a lot of energy, fuel oil. The oil prices was increasing and was increasing and was increasing. Now we are expecting that the price is getting little bit off going downtrend. Because for our power plant we have to buy the oil. For our LPG, we have to buy the LPG, so that it is this sort of trade war sometimes gives Bangladesh an opportunity. We cannot ignore that price might go down. This is a big threat for China and America. So China will take some advantage of relocating. There are sunset industries, I mean, this is not environment friendly. Industries will be relocated here. The coal-fired power plants will be not relocated here. So that's what we have to, the policy makers have to see that thing. So our policy makers must address that thing, what type of sunset industries or innovation or the technology Bangladesh, this is the time, should go and do the marketing in China to bring it here. Equally, Bangladeshi politicians should go to USA to show them that there is another potential opportunity for global supply chain, which is Bangladesh. So it is a political call. This is the right time. The politicians have to work very strongly, the government have to work very strongly, the chamber have to work very strongly, and this is the right time it has been addressed. So that there is three party can work together to bring the success of the opportunity of this challenge of this trade war. There is a lot of changes in the RMG. We were mostly doing the meatware products in Bangladesh, which is not value-added. There's a lot of value-added RMGs coming. So American market is fairly large, very large, but we are not strong in the American market, so that this is the high time, especially the government and the private sectors both should go and convince US government or even go to China government and convince that will give us an added advantage and get mileage. We should look into one issues. everybody, most of the people here are businessmen or either related with the business. So every day we have to open LC, which is very old-fashioned system of payments. How we are making the LCs? We are making the payments in dollar. So the cost of doing business is high. The exporter is, I'm importing from China, I'm paying in dollar, he gets paid in RMB. So there is a change of currency exchange. So there is a cost. So Bangladesh government should now negotiate with the China, because we are one of the largest trading partner. So Bangladesh government should convince or should have a relation that we can open the LC in direct on RMB. So we can bring the cost down. There is another opportunity, Blue Economy, BIMSTEC, Dhaka Chamber worked a lot of time. Multiple time we try to discuss and convince about the Blue Economy. In this table, in this room, we have discussed multiple time about the BIMSTEC. This is the time Bangladesh government or the politicians should address it seriously to get the advantage of that. Bangladesh is getting 100 economic zone. This economic zone is an opportunity. We can see a very good world economy. Our future economy will be very, very good, and we can see a bright future. There are a lot of changes, I think. I believe that there will be changes within the next 5-10 years. So we should take this opportunity to China. Because of this war, we have some opportunity. So we have to address that we can bring the Chinese companies here to explore the global markets. But we should be very careful right now. The China have the products. China have our products that they do not have the market. They cannot sell the product. So they will dump the price and they will cut the cost and sell it to Bangladesh-like countries. So we should be very careful about that. Because we have also local manufacturing capabilities. We have to address that. So there should be policy that China does not undercut their price and kill our local industries. So this is the policy. Policy should be addressed. And policy can be addressed better if we three work together, politicians, bureaucrats, and chambers. Without chamber, you do not know what is my challenge. You do not know what's the effect I'm getting from the steel or cost of energy. So chamber is the right place that you should talk to them first to understand that what is the challenge is an opportunity. Yes, infrastructure is the challenge, but infrastructure is also opportunity. We cannot ignore that. There is a lot of PPP project opportunities is there. We can invite even Chinese companies now, though they have shortage of fund and growth, but still they have hungriness on investing in projects. What they are investing in South America or Africa, we can bring that investments in Bangladesh. Bangladesh today is, I don't think that the business community is in a very right positions, especially what I feel. If you see that dollar fluctuations, dollar currency exchange, about 6 months back or year back, it was about $80 to $1, $80 to $1. Today is almost 84.50, which is very, very expensive, so that our cost of living is going high. So we have to change the process to bring in RMB uses RMB and import in RMB, and bank interest is also has gone high. That's also another challenges. So that how we can address that, addressing all these trade wars. Trade war is an opportunity, trade war is a threat. Both we have to address, and chamber can contribute heavily on that. Abaro bolte chai, din change hoyeche, jahajer byapari ki bole, adar byapari hoye jahajer khobor nawar shomoy hoye geche. Thank you for giving me the opportunity and have a good morning.
Thank you, sir. I would now request Dr. Mustafa Abid Khan, member, Bangladesh Tariff Commission, to present his views. Sir, your time is 7 minutes, sir.
Assalamu alaikum. Thank you, everybody. And thank you, DCCI and BFTA, for inviting me for this important session. I fully agree with the presentation made by Ali Ahmed, the CEO of BFTA, and also share the same views by Human Mishu, who is the actually practitioner, who is actually in the business. So let me go back to the historical perspective. So there's the Trump policy. Trump policy was, you know, actually to bring back the investment to US. So your investor went to China and other countries, they wanted to bring the businessmen to US. And first he actually started with the income tax reduction policy. And what happened, you know, that it did not result any, you know, fruitful, you know, outcome, because, you know, the people are moving not from China, they are not going back to US, but mostly they are going, shifting their, you know, investment from China to other countries. So he started the tariff imposition. He started with the aluminium and steel, but it is on MFN basis, but their commitment was, you know, actually 0%. So it actually, what happened that US is under the violation of the WTO obligation. That's the major issue with the WTO. And then, you know, he came with this, you know, trade war against China, and they started, he threatened to impose all tariff on Chinese port, all Chinese product, and then he started with that 53 billion of US import, and then he started that one. And now they are threatening to impose, you know, duty on all products. And that is the key issue. So, actually, that if we go through the history of, you know, the USTR, the present USTR, you will see that he is a lawyer, and he is actually whole, you know, life, his career was against China, against import of China. So he is very conversant with the Chinese policies, everything. So he started with that one. So this trade war, what we effect, as you rightly point out, is that first, and you know, that it is the price and the trade diversion. The trade diversion is the effect of the price diversion, and then investment. So basically what we can see that, you know, there are three, areas where, you know, that we can feel some changes in trade as well as investment, because if trade is diverted to other countries, then investment will divert it from China to other countries. So the first one is electronics, because US already, you know, as you know, as rightly pointed out, made in China 2025 policy, it was actually targeted to, you know, all, you know, electronic products of China. They wanted to develop that one, skill, knowledge, everything. So the US first, you know, hit the electronic item. And what we see that if there is a diversion, where diversion may go? It's a Vietnam. Vietnam and Malaysia and electronic products. And, you know, they have huge, you know, possibilities. Because, you know, that so far, I remember, I don't know what is the figure, but in 2013-14, I've seen this figure that 52% of Vietnam export is coming from the foreign direct investment, not the domestic. So they actually put emphasis on the foreign direct investment, and they develop huge facility for them. And that's why, you know, and they have electronic, you know, their largest export product are electronics, Vietnam. So they can easily absorb the diversion which are going to happen from China. So they have only possibility, and then we have Malaysia for EIC. Unfortunately, Bangladesh cannot take up this opportunity. That's a problem. Although, you know, we are talking about the ICT sector for a long time, but unfortunately, due to, you know, human resource capacity and infrastructure capacity, we cannot take advantage of that one. Then we have automobile, but automobile, again, Bangladesh is not a player, and we cannot take advantage of that one. Then still, I'm sure that, you know, Energy Pack has one steel manufacturing industry, but we are not prominent. Actually, we don't export. So, and that's why I don't think that Bangladesh can take opportunity. I was looking for clothing, you know, that what will happen in the apparel sector. You know, I was looking for, you know, the Chinese tariff, US tariff on China clothing, but still there is nothing. That's a problem. That's a, you know, that that's an issue. But you know that what I see, that there is a chilling effect, that you know, Trump said that, you know, the all Chinese product would be subject to higher tariff. So the exporter and importer are booming towards Bangladesh. That's a good sign, and our VCPB may confirm that one. During the last 3-4 months, our export to US actually increased significantly. So there is a chilling effect. But you see that if US imposed tariff on China, Bangladesh can take advantage of that. But only issue that, you know, that only issue I see in that case, you know, the rules of origin issue. Rules of origin issue means that, you know, that Bangladesh basically, we, for oven garments, you know, because we basically export oven to US and knitwear to some extent, but we are less competitive than Vietnam in US market. But what we basically import fabrics and then export the product, the garments. But so far I don't know that US have a specific rules of origin criteria for textile sector. But if we import fabric, say from China or any other countries, and then China, and then we export to China, then they may say that no, it is not a Bangladeshi product, it is a Chinese product, and they can impose higher tariff. So that may be one issue. It may happen because of the rules of origin. So only we see that, you know, that what I see, that there is an opportunity. I remember that one in 1980s, we took the opportunity of Sri Lankan problem. So they shifted to Bangladesh, and then there was a quota on Korean textile apparel sector, so they moved to Bangladesh. So there is certainly there is an opportunity. The issue is for Bangladesh are two issues basically, that, you know, one is the infrastructure. Unless we can, we develop our infrastructure, it's, industry will not come, that's sure. And the second one, the human resource. You see, you know, we have to admit that we have our lacking in human resource capacity. You know, we can, over the period, we have a lot of engineers, we have all the, we have the engineers, so, but we can even, you know, produce, you know, simple electronic goods, you know. No, I've been working, you know, on electric. I thought that, you know, Bangladesh has the opportunity to, you know, produce the electronic good, but it did not happen. We need to actually develop the human resource capacity through quality of education, through proper training, and, you know, we have to develop the trading facility even by the private sector, and we need to give incentive to the private sector so that they can develop the training facilities. I thank you very much. Bye.
Thank you, sir. I now request Dr. M. Mashrur Riaz, Senior Economist and Program Manager, International Finance Corporation, IFC, World Bank Group, to give his comments within 7 minutes, sir.
Thank you. Today's Chair, DCCI President, Mr. Khan, Special Guest, Chief Guest, Mr. Subhashish Bose, Senior Secretary of Commerce, Special Guest, Presenter, my fellow panelists, DCCI Board Members, Ladies and Gentlemen, Assalamu Alaikum. And good afternoon. Like to thank both DCCI and BFTI for organizing what I also believe is perhaps the first systematic discussion on this very important issue, which has real implications on Bangladesh. And I'm really glad you used the word implication rather than impact, because it would go beyond impact in terms of Bangladesh's readiness and actions. And I think the presentation was all-encompassing, quite holistic. You started from definition all the way to evolution of the war, and then the impact, as well as you finish with Bangladesh's policy action. So thank you, Mr. Ali Ahmed, for that. Let me first bring in this trade war through the lens of what has been a key driver of global prosperity over the last few decades, at least, which is trade liberalization. I think the benefits are well established and proven, and the potentials are widespread for the world to take advantage of trade liberalization. There is no country in the recent world which has got sustained growth and economic prosperity without opening their markets and investment to the world. If we look at the most recent economic success or miracle, which is East Asia, their average tariff, which is a quite an important measure of trade protection or trade liberalization initiative, came down from that of 30%, I think in not long ago, early 90s, to that of, for ASEAN, around 4%, and for East Asian countries, around 7.5% in these recent times. There are costs of liberalization, trade liberalization, but it has also been established the benefits of trade liberalization. It outweighs the cost by a factor of 10 times, by a factor of 10. So the 10 times benefit one can get at, by liberalizing the trade regime. And we see the examples in Vietnam, India, even Bangladesh, you know, which has taken a path of trade liberalization from early 90s. There are a lot more to do in trade liberalization. One study by IMF, it's a bit dated, I think a decade old now, estimated that by eliminating the remaining trade barriers around the world, the global trading community can reap the benefit between $650 billion to $1 trillion a year in terms of trading. Now, two-thirds of that will go to industrial countries. However, the one-third that goes to the developing countries would be 2 to 3 times more than the aid they receive. So that's how important trade liberalization is, even for the future. Now, what is the scenario between China and US in terms of, or as a result of this trade war? Now, Mr. Ahmed has shed light, and my fellow panelists, both Abid Bhai and Umain Bhai, also shed light. But let me give a few more extra numbers. So there was a study by a group of US, Canadian, Indian, and Chinese researchers. So they came up with a hypothesis that if US is to impose a 10% tariff on all US, on all Chinese imports, and China retaliates in the same way, then US GDP will go down by about 1.1%. China will go down by 0.64%. US investments will go down by 3%, and unemployment will go up by more than 1%. What it means is that Chinese export overall will go down by 1.76, and that's a lot, because it's almost a $1.3 trillion export economy. But this would also mean China will import 3.8% less from its trading partners. Now, that has lot of implication on Bangladesh. There are some good ones as well, and something that has been mentioned by the speakers previous to me. So in the, it will, for example, in terms of trade, apparel and textile, it is expected to get Bangladesh some higher share. It is also expected to get some investment through the relocation window, but they're all going to be short term. In the medium and long term, not only Bangladesh, I think the whole world has a lot to lose. And primarily because we are talking about the numbers I've just given you, we are talking about the two largest economies of the world. Now, this is pointing to economic slowdown in US and economic slowdown in China. Now, if US is going to be a big market for our ready-made garments and textile, and a slowdown and an unemployment there, and a slowdown in investment is not going to help us in long run. Similarly, in China, 30% of China's, or the 30% of China's total export are actually sourced from other countries, particularly from Asia, because this is a world of global value chain, no longer a world of final or finished good export. Everybody take part in a value chain, and that's where I think dangers are for Bangladesh, because Chinese import of Bangladeshi products hopefully are expected to rise. But if Chinese economy goes into slowdown, if Chinese exports go down, Chinese imports will also go down, and that is going to impact Bangladesh significantly. But it is not only going to impact Bangladesh in terms of trade or export. It is also going to impact through investment, through diversification effort, which Ministry of Commerce is leading under the able leadership of Senior Secretary Mr. Bose, but also this whole agenda of further liberalization. Now Bangladesh, so let me go one by one. Investment, as I say, in short term, relocation industries are going to be positive. I mean, overall, in the long run, if the Chinese economy is bad and if it has impact on the East Asian economy, the potential investor list, if you look at BIDA or at BISA, most of them are coming from the East Asian countries, and this is going to slow down that flow of investors into Bangladesh. Diversification agenda, export diversification or export-led growth is the cornerstone of Bangladesh's growth strategy, and Ministry of Commerce, through its Export Competitiveness for Growth initiative, is taking the strong initiatives to go beyond our ready-made garment, to develop new sectors. Now this is going to be hit because mark efficiency seeking FDI, which will utilize Bangladesh's factor market productivity, then will export from here, is going to be impacted, particularly again from the East Asian markets, East Asian countries. And finally, the trade liberalization agenda is also going to be impacted. Bangladesh has come a long way since early 90s in terms of opening up its overall trade regime. But it is still, or South Asia in general, is still one of the higher region, and Bangladesh is a country which still has a higher protection. The average tariff in 2017 in Bangladesh was 25%, South Asia was 13%, East Asia was 7%, ASEAN countries were around 4%. So Bangladesh has a lot more to do in trade liberalization, but this sort of trade war is going to change the tone. There are winners and losers in any reforms. So the losers are really going to be emboldened by this sort of global tone in terms of trade reform, trade war. So what does Bangladesh have to do? I think four things, and some of those have been touched upon by other speakers. Now, if Bangladesh has to get more of the relocation industry, more of the relocation export, now Bangladesh has to increase its productivity, because a lot of these US sanctions, not sanctions, the higher tariffs are actually on high-end products like machinery, technology, robotics, aeroplane or aerospace. Now, does Bangladesh have the productivity, which means skills and technology to do this? No, I agree with Avid Bhai. If you come down to ready-made garments as well, China's $200 billion ready-made garments, it's mostly high value. Again, you're going to need productivity, and in terms of diversification in light manufacturing, electronics and so on, Bangladesh will need upgraded compliance standards, compliance with standards, environmental, social, particularly quality. Does Bangladesh have it now? It's improving, not quite there yet. Third, cost competitiveness. Infrastructure is a big issue. Now their access to land and power has been greatly addressed. However, trade infrastructure remains quite weak. The handling of, at the port and the everything between the factory and the port, that remains to be further developed. And the ease of doing business that Ali Ahmed Bhai mentioned, that imposes a cost on Bangladesh's entrepreneurs. So that needs to be addressed. There are lots of good initiatives going on by the government, but now it needs to be brought to actions, time-bound actions, because again by April 30th, next year's doing business report timing will be over, and if the actions cannot be completed, the October 2019 report perhaps will not upgrade Bangladesh in terms of its overall ranking, and the ranking reflects what's on the ground. And fourth, finally, continued trade reforms. There are a number of initiatives, but a particular emphasis needs to come on tariff rationalization strategically to support Bangladesh's export-led growth. Thank you so much again, Dhaka Chamber and BFTA.
Thank you, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, it is now time for open discussion. May I request Mr. Abul Kashim Khan, President DCCI, to moderate the session.
Thank you. So we have about 15 minutes for open discussion. So we have about eight possible speakers or participants. So I would request all the participants to be very short. If there is a question, then ask the question, and I'll give you 1 to 2 minutes for each. This is language neutral, so most welcome to also say in Bangla. Apnara jodi Banglay kono proshno korte chan, apnara paren. And then I'll sum up, and if needed, I'll come to the keynote presenter for his clarification. So I will start with Mrs. Sharifa Khan, Additional Secretary, Ministry of Commerce. Ma'am.
Thank you very much for giving me the opportunity and the first discussant in this session. I'll first congratulate BAFTI and Dhaka Chamber for organizing such an important seminar, which has great impact, we believe, that on Bangladesh. The analysis came here is really interesting, but I also have one idea that the US did not impose this measure or take this measure without having their own analysis. We have to think they have their own analysis and they have their remedial measures. We have to think, because the global recession we are expecting this time, it should not be like 1930s recession, because that time the importer was very less, number of exporter was very less. But now they have diversification all across the globe. So we have to take this opportunity as a diversified exporters and importers. How can we do that? Because I always think the pessimist always find challenges in opportunities, and optimist always find opportunities in challenges. So I like to find challenges in this, opportunities in these challenges. And we can do it in two ways. One is to use we are now the growing economy. There are lots of big projects are going, development works are going on. So we need to take this opportunity to accelerate our development pace, because the global prices of steel and aluminium has gone down, and that has the major basic items for many of the electronic industry infrastructure projects. So we need to utilize how we can utilize the lower prices of steel and aluminium for our development infrastructure project, as well as to industrial capacity, because many of the industries uses steel and aluminium. But we also need to take this opportunity to enhance our supply side, because so there are lots of views that the rules of origin, criteria, market, globalization, but the product we are exporting, the low-end product, so I think the basic demand for clauses that we need will remain, will not affect that much during this period, and we can still continue with that. But we also need to think of whether other we can utilize the sunset industries that will come to Bangladesh, but we are the same, and whether we can diversify, taking these opportunities as a strategy for diversification in our economy. And for that we need to have a big careful planning, and we need to have a team consisting of the members of the public, private sectors, as well as academician. And like the Mashur Riaz told, that we need to have change our ease of doing business, and skill development is the must be a priority for us. But we also need to be very careful about the shifting or relocation of industries, because we apprehend that the lots of industries will come that will have a very hazardous, environmentally hazardous. We need to be very careful in bringing the industries or hosting those industries which will take. So that needs a policy analysis for that, which industries will host and will give the priority. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. I'll come back to you. Can I request Mr. Rashidul Karim Munna, MD Creation Private Limited, and also convener of the SDG committee?
Yes, sir. আমি আসলে কয়েকটা পয়েন্ট মেনশন করতে চাইছি স্পেসিফিক্যালি। সেটা হচ্ছে যে অপরচুনিটি তো আসছে, কিন্তু ওয়ার্ল্ড সাপ্লাই চেইনে বাংলাদেশকে কিভাবে পজিটিভলি প্রমোট করা যায় সেই বিষয়টা আসলে ভাবতে হবে। কারণ হচ্ছে আমি জাস্ট গত সপ্তাহে ইউরোপে ছিলাম, তা এই বিষয়টা কিন্তু বাইরের সাইড থেকেও চিন্তা করছে যে চায়নার অল্টারনেটিভ কান্ট্রিগুলো কী কী হতে পারে। সেক্ষেত্রে আমি মনে করি যে গার্মেন্টসের যে একটা পজিটিভ ইমেজ ক্রিয়েট করা হয়েছে, অন্যান্য সেক্টরে আমরা কীভাবে করতে পারি এই বিষয়টা একটি জোরালোভাবে চিন্তা করা দরকার। দ্বিতীয়ত যে বিষয়টা চলে আসছে যে গার্মেন্টসের পাশাপাশি অন্যান্য সেক্টরে কম্পায়েন্স বেসড ফ্যাক্টরি, অর্থাৎ সার্টিফিকেশনের বিষয়টা কিন্তু খুব জোরালোভাবে চলে আসছে এবং অনেকটা কম্পালসারি হয়ে গেছে। তো সেই ক্ষেত্রে আমরা মনে করি যে গার্মেন্টসের পাশাপাশি অন্যান্য সেক্টরের ফ্যাক্টরিগুলোকে কীভাবে কম্পায়েন্স সার্টিফিকেশনের আন্ডারে আনা যায় তার জন্য একটি সমন্বিত পরিকল্পনা জোরালোভাবে এই মুহূর্তে নেওয়া দরকার। এই দুটো পয়েন্টগুলো আমি শেষ করছি। থ্যাংক ইউ।
থ্যাংক ইউ। ক্যান আই কাম টু ডক্টর এম ডি খায়রুজ্জামান মজুমদার ফ্রম দি ফাইন্যান্স ডিভিশন? স্যার, ইউ হ্যাভ টু মিনিটস।
থ্যাংক ইউ স্যার। I'd like to congratulate Mr. Alang for his excellent presentation, because in 25 minutes span of time he has covered all the basic points that relates to this debate. And in fact, I will have three observations very briefly, because I know I have 2 months, 2 minutes time. The first one is already covered by Mr. Master Riaz, which is a very important point which has not been highlighted in the original presentation, that is the value chain impact. I will not go into detail because he has covered. I will just give one example. If we look at the leather sector, the performance during the last 4 months, we can see that it has gone down more than 27%. This is because of this, because we have not been able to export finished leather to China as we are doing during the previous year. The similar impact is happening in India and Indonesia also. They are the largest exporter of raw materials and intermediate goods to China, and this is now being affected. The second observation is the bigger thy neighbor policy, because as soon as the US started imposing these tariffs on China, China has started revaluing its currency. And this kind of currency war is actually hampering Bangladesh. The most important issue is we are seeing the similar tendency among the other countries like India. Now Bangladeshi taka is almost 1 rupee. The problem is, why China is doing this is to offset the tariff impact on its import. So if this is happening, and in the very soon you will be able to see that China has already been able to offset the impact, then the impact on Bangladesh, positive impact that we are seeing, during the last 4 months, the growth in ready-made garments is almost more than 20%. This will not be happening in the future, because China will again be able to recapture its market in the USA. The third observation is the resurgence of production. SAR has highlighted whether it will go to a recession. In fact, to tell you very frankly, I mean, in 1930, there was the Smoot and Hawley Act in USA. And it was one of the major reasons for the Great Depression, because as soon as the US did this, the other countries followed suit, and there was a huge spike of protectionism throughout the world. And that was one of the reasons for the Great Depression. Although SAR has said that this current trade war will not go as far as that kind of trade depression, I mean, I'm referring to Ms. Sharifa. But my hint is that the policymakers in the US will realize this, and they will ultimately make some remedial measures. Because one impact, as Dr. Mustafa Abid was saying, is the investment impact. Because I have seen in newspapers that because of the Chinese tariff, because what China is doing by the bigger thy neighbor policy, America cannot do that, because its currency is dollar. So due to this, and in addition to the impact of Chinese tariff, counter tariff, the US industries will face the music. And for example, the Harley Davidson, this is just an example, it's not the prime case. They said that in order to retain their market in China, they will shift part of their production process in China. And you may see this will happen in the case of GM, Ford, Chrysler also. So ultimately, this will not lead to, this will not prolong, and ultimately you will find that China and the US will come to their senses, and there will be one remedial action, and finally this trade war will not be there. But ultimately, my point is that the trade war has been an eye-opener for our countries, and as explained by all, this will be a big scope for the policymakers in Bangladesh to think about how to deal with this kind of crisis in the future. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Can I request Mr. Alhaj Abdul Salam, former Senior Vice President?
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Assalamu alaikum and welcome to DCCI all. এখানে দেখা যায় আমরা সবাই বাঙালি, কিন্তু পেপারগুলো যদি বাংলায় হতো তাহলে আরো অনেক সুবিধা হতো, কারণ আমাদের প্রাইম মিনিস্টার যখন কথাবার্তা বলেন তখন বাংলায় বলেন। যাই হোক, আমরা কতগুলো পয়েন্টে এখানে আসছি সেগুলো হলো মাই স্পিচ উইল বি ইন বাংলা সো দ্যাট সরি ফর দ্যাট ওয়ান কারণ অনেকে বুঝতে অসুবিধা হতে পারে বাট যদিও আমরা বাঙালি এখানে আমি প্রথমে ধন্যবাদ জানাই আমাদের চিফ গেস্ট স্পেশাল গেস্ট এবং প্যানেল ডিসকাশনে যিনারা আছেন তার মধ্যে একটা কথা এখানে আসে আমাদের হুমায়ুন রশিদ ভাই আমি ওনার ফ্যাক্টরি ভিজিট করেছি ঢাকা চেম্বারের পক্ষ থেকে এবং দেখলাম একটা হিউজ কোম্পানি যথেষ্ট ইনভেস্টমেন্ট সেখানে আছে বাট দে আর ফেসিং সাম প্রবলেম অ্যাবাউট দ্য এক্সপোর্ট সো এগুলোর দিকে একটু নজর রাখা উচিত যে হাউ উইল বি আই মিন সাকসেসফুল অ্যাবাউট দ্য এক্সপোর্ট অফ দিস পার্টিকুলার ফিউ আইটেমস এখানে আমরা আরও কথা বলবো কিন্তু তার আগে আমাদের প্যানেল ডিসকাশন এসে গেছে সেটা হলো এক্সপোর্ট প্রমোশন ব্যুরোর সঙ্গে আমাদের সম্পূর্ণভাবে একটা লিঙ্ক আছে এক্সপোর্ট প্রমোশন ব্যুরো আমাদের এক্সপোর্টের জন্য কিন্তু অনেক হেল্প করতে পারে আমরা যখন পিএমের সঙ্গে চায়নায় গেলাম তখন আমি একটু আগেই বলে গেছি যদিও এক্সপোর্ট প্রমোশন ব্যুরোর এখানে চিফ আসেন বসা তার নোটিশে আমি দিয়ে রাখছি উনি ওইটা জানেনও ওখানে কিন্তু বিদেশে স্লাইড দেখানো হয় যারা যারা পার্টিসিপেট করেন শেষে দেশের উন্নত মানের জিনিসপত্র সেখানে দেখানো হয় কিন্তু আমরা যখন দেখলাম হলের ভিতরে যে আমাদের যে আপনার স্লাইডটা দেখানো হলো খুব বেশি একটা ভালো একটা নজরে আসলো না সঙ্গে সঙ্গে আমরা এটা ওনার নোটিশেও দিয়েছিলাম তো আগামীতে আমরা আশা করি যখন এক্সপোর্ট প্রমোশন ব্যুরোর মধ্যে যখন বিদেশে আমরা যাই আমাদের এগুলো স্লাইড দেখানো হয় কারণ ওগুলো দেখানোর বিনিময়ে কিন্তু আমরা অনেকটা অর্ডারও পেয়ে থাকি এবং আমার দেশে যদি ওনারা আসে তো জয়েন্ট ভেঞ্চারেও আমরা কাজ করতে পারি তো এখানে রশিদ ভাই একটা কথা বললেন যে আদার ব্যাপারে জাহাজের খবর রাখা সত্যি সত্যি এটা উনি বড় দুঃখের জন্য সঙ্গে বলেছেন কিন্তু আমাদের নেক্সট জেনারেশন ইনশাআল্লাহ ইনশাআল্লাহ উইল কাম আপ অ্যান্ড যেগুলো আমাদের এখানে উন্নত মানের যেগুলো কাজকর্ম হবে দে উইল লুক আফটার দিস থিং থ্যাংক ইউ ভেরি মাচ এভরিবডি
থ্যাংক ইউ ক্যান আই কাম টু মিস্টার এনামুল হক পাটওয়ারি ফর্মার চেয়ারম্যান বাংলাদেশ জুট গুডস অ্যাসোসিয়েশন অ্যান্ড আওয়ার কনভেনার
আসসালামু আলাইকুম অ্যান্ড গুড আফটারনুন টু ইউ অল আমি জুট গুডস এক্সপোর্টার অ্যাসোসিয়েশনকে প্রতিনিধিত্ব করতাম এখনও জুট গুডস এক্সপোর্ট করি এখানে এক্সপোর্টের যে আমাদের অ্যাকচুয়ালি আরএনজি লেদার এবং জুট জুটের পজিশন থার্ড জুটের কিন্তু কোনো আলোচনা হয়নি এ পর্যন্ত আরএনজির কথা এসেছে লেদারের কথা এসেছে লেদার ডিক্লাইন করেছে আরএনজি এক্স ভালো করতেছে জুটের পজিশন কিন্তু খুব খারাপ আমি যদি ওইভাবে সংক্ষেপে বলি যে জুটের পজিশনটা খারাপ এই জন্য যে আমরা জুট গুড় যেখানে এক্সপোর্ট করি যে বিশেষ করে আফ্রিকান কান্ট্রি মিডল ইস্ট এইসব কান্ট্রিতে ডিভ্যালুয়েশন এত হয়েছে যে কল্পনার বাইরে আমরা ডলারের সাথে যে কারেন্সি ডিভ্যালুয়েশন ইভেন আমার প্রতিবেশী দেশ ইন্ডিয়া এবং চায়নাতে 7% মতো ডিভ্যালু 7% প্লাস ডিভ্যালু হয়েছে ইন্ডিয়াতে 10% বেশি ডিভ্যালু হয়েছে আমাদের অ্যাকচুয়ালি আমাদের ডলারে এখন স্টেবল পজিশনে আছে কিন্তু আমরা যখন কস্ট অ্যানালাইস এক্সপোর্টে যখন অফার করি আমরা তো আমাদের ডলার এবং আমার লোকাল প্রাইসকে কনসিডারেশন নিয়ে করি আমরা যখন যেহেতু ডিভ্যালু হওয়াতে আমরা যে চায়নার সাথে এবং ভারতের সাথে আমাদের প্রতিবেশী দেশের সাথে যেটা যারা কম্পিটিটর তাদের সাথে কিন্তু আমরা বিজনেস হারিয়ে ফেলতেছি আমি রিসেন্টলি কিন্তু 62 ভিতরে আমার কনফার্ম বিজনেসটাও শেষ পর্যন্ত প্রায় পার্টনে $100 ডিফারেন্স এটা আমার প্রতিবেশী দেশে চলে গেছে তা আমরা এই ডলার ডিভ্যালুয়েশনটার আমি এখানে অ্যাকচুয়ালি আমাদের কিনোটের স্পিকার উনি অনেক কিছু বলেছেন অনেক সুন্দরভাবে উপস্থাপন করেছেন এবং সব ঘটনাগুলি বিস্তারিত আলোচিত হয়েছে তো ইম্প্যাক্ট অন বাংলাদেশের পজিশনে যদি আমি এক্সপোর্ট টার্মে যদি আসি আমরা যদি ডলারটা ডিভ্যালু করবো না করবো এটা সরকারের ব্যাপার কিন্তু আমি চিফ গেস্টটা ওনার কাছে আমার একটা প্রশ্ন থাকবে এবং কিনোট স্পিকারের কাছে এটা একটা অ্যানালাইসিস থাকবে যে আমরা এই পর্যায়ে কেন এক্সপোর্ট হারাবো এবং এক্সপোর্টটাকে কীভাবে ব্যবহার অ্যাক্সিলারেট করা যায় সেটার জন্য যে কী ধরনের মেজার নিতে পারে আমার এই প্রশ্নটা রেখে আমি শেষ করতেছি কারণ আমরা কিন্তু এই বিজনেস আমাদের ডিক্লাইন এখানে লেদারের কথা বলেছে 20% ডিক্লাইন করেছে
যে আমি পয়েন্টটা বুঝেছি থ্যাংক ইউ থ্যাংক ইউ
জুটগুডস কিন্তু তার চেয়েও বেশি ডিক্লাইন করেছে ধন্যবাদ
জি থ্যাংক ইউ Can I come to Dr. Muhammad Abu Yusuf, Deputy Secretary, Ministry of Finance? Yeah, 2 minutes, sir.
Assalamualaikum. First of all, I would like to thank Dhaka Chamber of Commerce and Industry and the BFTI for organizing such a timely seminar on a very concurrent topic, trade war and its implications for Bangladesh. To save time without addressing anyone, I am going to straight going to my points. I will first extend my congratulations to Mr. Ali Ahmed, CEO BFTI, for a wonderful presentation. In his presentation, he has covered almost all the points. So actually, nothing left that I can elaborate on. I will just highlight one of his presentation topic, dot point, in one of his places. He described that the shift of US and EU orders are more to Vietnam, Cambodia, or even to Myanmar than in Bangladesh. Now, it indicates that we must not be very elated that business are coming from China to Bangladesh. Other competing countries are even getting more than what we are doing. Now we have to analyze why these are happening. So I will confine my discussion on three dot points. First one is I will say a little bit about competitive strategy of Bangladesh, and then I will say very, very briefly on investment, and then many basically on these two points.
Within 1 minute.
Maybe 1 minute. In our perspective plan, chapter 5, Government of Bangladesh has detailed our competitive strategy as a country, where a lot of discussion are made about policy supports, product diversification, market diversification, quality diversification, intermediate diversification, everything. Now, we have to think about implementation. We are lagging behind in implementing mega projects. We are not good in our human capital development, you know. We have to import a lot of our middle-level managers from Sri Lanka, from India, and from many other countries. And you know that World Bank report where it has been mentioned that Bangladesh is a great source of earnings for other countries. So my emphasis will be that we need to focus more on our capacity and skills development in order to support or underpin our growth trajectory over the next 10-15 years. The second point is that in international business, once upon a time, there was a big emphasis on location, location, and location. But I'd love to say for Bangladesh, our emphasis should be on implementation, implementation, and implementation. In respect of mega projects, in respect of our curriculum, in respect of our quality education, in respect of our diversification. The good thing is that the government of Bangladesh, Honorable Finance Minister, has rightly identified for intervention that over the next 5-10 years, anti-export bias against non-RMG items will be handled, and government has taken steps, and we are also seeing the results with regard to cash incentives and other ones. The next point that I'd love to mention, I'm finishing very soon. Just I think 3-4 days ago, Mr. Selim Ryan has featured an article. A feature article was featured on the Daily Star about our investment, GDP, and ICON. In that write-up, he has vividly mentioned that if we want to achieve 9% GDP after 3-4 years, then at an incremental capital output ratio of 4.4%, we have to have attract 40% FDI as a percentage of GDP. But now you understand what is our level of investment, and we need to soul search, and we need to do not many work. Why we are not getting the level of investment that we expect to? These 2 hours, I'd love to finish here. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. Can I come to Mr. MD Abdul Suban, Deputy General Manager? Sir, 1 minute. I am running out of time.
Thank you very much. Not 1 minute, 30 seconds is enough for myself. Thank you. Thank you very much for your organizer who arranged the trade war and its implications for Bangladesh. It is a timely seminar on, and because of it is a, this issue is a very crucial and burning issue in the world. You know that the Bangladesh is a very small country, but the economy, the world economy is now slowing day by day. So there is two dominant sectors in Bangladesh. The one is ready-made garments, and another is remittance. The, if we slow down the economy, then what is the impact and implication of Bangladesh economy? This is my questions. Thank you.
Can I come to Barrister Sayam Malik? 30 seconds.
Thank you very much. I'm Barrister Muhammad Sayamuddin Malik. One thing I want to say that we are technologically far behind, and our policy makers and bureaucrats are known for speed. We have to make the most out of the social networks for promoting our goods worldwide. Our entrepreneurs will have to learn new strategies for global marketing. The government can also invite the foreign investor to bilateral talks so that the foreign investor will be more encouraged to do business with Bangladesh, and that is how we can defeat our other Asian competitors. We must further strengthen the greening of our industry by looking at the demand of the green products of global consumer. Our garments factories have already started to be green, and now we have to focus on other sectors as well so that the foreign investor will become more interested. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you for keeping it within 1 minute. Mr. Khair M. Khan, former director. 30 seconds, sir.
Dhanyabad. Bismillah Rahman Rahim. Aajke je amader trade war sambandhe je seminar cholche, ami prothome Alihan sir ke dhanyabad janai onar tinor paper er jonno khub prishkar. Ebong amra bolte chaichi je kichu din goto mashe 28 tarike আমরা ডেস্টিনেশন বাংলাদেশ বলে একটি আন্তর্জাতিক সেমিনার করেছি, সেখানে আমাদের এফডিআইয়ের উপরে অনেক কথাবার্তা হয়েছে। সেটারই আলোকে এইটা অত্যন্ত এটা আশাবাদী যে আমরা যে বর্তমানে যে আমেরিকাতে গিয়ে এই চলছে ট্রেড ওয়ার চলছে, সেখান থেকে কিছু এফডিআই আমরা আনতে পারি কিনা সেই আশাতে আমাদের 10টি ইকোনমিক জোন তৈরি হয়েছে প্রায়। এগুলোকে কীভাবে আমরা রিভাইভ করতে পারি, গ্রিন ইন্ডাস্ট্রিগুলো আমাদের সেই গ্রিন ইন্ডাস্ট্রিগুলো রিভাইভ করার জন্য আমরা কী কী পদক্ষেপ নিতে পারি, আমরা সেই সেই ব্যাপারে সরকার একটা ব্যবস্থা নেবেন। আর আমাদের দেশে এখন আমরা যেটা বলবো, যেটা আমরা বিভিন্ন রাষ্ট্রের থেকে আমাদের দেশে আমদানি করে থাকি, বর্তমানে আমি ট্যারিফ কমিশনের নাম পরিবর্তন করে এটাকে ট্রেড অ্যান্ড ট্যারিফ কমিশন করা হয়েছে এবং বাণিজ্য মন্ত্রণালয়ের দৃষ্টি আকর্ষণ করছি। আমাদের দেশে এখন মোটর সাইকেলের দারুণ ব্যবসা চলছে, কিন্তু ভারত থেকে যে সমস্ত বাইক আমাদের দেশে ইম্পোর্ট হচ্ছে তার লংজিটি বলতে কিছুই নেই। উইদিন 2 ইয়ার্সের মধ্যে এগুলো রাস্তায় ইয়ে হয়ে যায়। বাণিজ্য মন্ত্রণালয় দিল্লি এ ব্যাপারে পদক্ষেপ নেন যে আমাদের দেশে যে সমস্ত মাল ইম্পোর্ট হবে তার লংজিভিটি থাকবে, তার একটা ইম্পোর্টার তার গ্যারেন্টি দিবে, এই ব্যাপারটা দেখার জন্য ধন্যবাদ।
থ্যাংক ইউ ফর ফিনিশিং উইদিন 1 মিনিট। লাস্ট স্পিকার তপন কান্তি ঘোষ, অ্যাডিশনাল সেক্রেটারি মিনিস্ট্রি অফ কমার্স। স্যার, ইওর টাইম ইজ 1 মিনিট।
ধন্যবাদ। আমরা অনেক আলোচনা শুনেছি, আমি দু একটি কথা বলতে চাচ্ছি। যে গত কয়েক বছর ধরে কিন্তু শোনা যাচ্ছিল যে চায়না থেকে রিলোকেশন হয়ে আমাদের এক্সপোর্ট অনেক বাড়বে, তো সেই প্রেক্ষাপটে আমি এটা দেখতে চাই। এখন আজকে যে ইম্পোজিশন হচ্ছে চাইনিজ গুডসের উপরে, সেখান থেকে বাংলাদেশ এক্সপোর্টে টু দ্য ইউএস মার্কেট কতটা সুবিধা নিতে পারবে, তো আমার মনে হচ্ছে যে প্রোডাক্টগুলো আমাদের মেজর এক্সপোর্ট আইটেম সেখানে কিন্তু ইম্পোজিশনের মধ্যে নাই, তো তাহলে প্রথমেই কিন্তু আমাদের সুযোগটা হয়তো কমে যাচ্ছে। দ্বিতীয়ত হচ্ছে যে গত 3-4 বছর যদি এক্সপোর্ট টু ইউএস দেখি আমরা, তাহলে 3 বছর আগে আমরা এক্সপোর্ট যেখানে গিয়েছিল আমেরিকার 6.2 বিলিয়ন, আমরা গত বছর কিন্তু সেই পর্যন্ত পৌঁছাতে পারিনি, মানে 3 বছর আগেরটাই আমরা এখন অ্যাটেন্ড করতে পারিনি, গত বছর 5.9 বিলিয়ন। সুতরাং সেখানে সমস্যা আছে। আর আমেরিকাতে আমাদের সবচেয়ে বড় ইস্যু, আমরা যে কোনো আলোচনা এখন দেখি যে তারা লেবার ইস্যুটাকে নিয়ে আসে এবং ইপিজেড লেবার একটা সংস্কারের কথা বলে। সুতরাং যখনই আমরা 100টা এসিজেডে ইনভেস্টমেন্টের কথা বলছি, স্পেশাল ইকোনমিক জোন, স্পেশাল ইকোনমিক জোনের আইনটাতে কিন্তু বলা হয়েছে যে ইপিজেড আইনে লেবার রাইটস যেমন দেওয়া হয়েছে সেরকম। সুতরাং এই কমপ্লায়েন্স ইস্যুতে কিন্তু আমরা যতই এফডিআই আসুক, এইখানে আবার কিন্তু ইউএসএতে আমাদের এক্সপোর্টটা আটকে দেওয়ার একটা অনেক চেষ্টা হবে যদি না আমরা নেগোসিয়েশনের মাধ্যমে এই জায়গাটা ফয়সলা করতে পারি। ধন্যবাদ।
থ্যাংক ইউ। আই থিঙ্ক উই নিড টু এন্ড দি ওপেন ডিসকাশন বিফোর এন্ডিং। আমি একটু যদি সাম আপ করি ফর আওয়ার কি নোট প্রেজেন্টার ফর হিজ রিয়াকশন ইফ হি চুজেস সো। আই উইল স্টার্ট উইথ ব্যারিস্টার সায়ম মালিক, হি টকড অ্যাবাউট টেকনোলজি অ্যান্ড এফডিআই হুইচ ইজ ভেরি ইম্পর্টেন্ট ফর আস। মিস শরীফা খান, অ্যাডিশনাল সেক্রেটারি, টকড অ্যাবাউট দি 3 চ্যালেঞ্জেস অ্যান্ড অপরচুনিটিস বেসিক্যালি ইনফ্রাস্ট্রাকচারে আমাদের যেই মোমেন্টামটা আছে সাপ্লাই সাইড নিয়ে কথা বলেছেন, এবং সানসেট ইন্ডাস্ট্রির যে একটা পসিবিলিটি আছে ফ্রম চায়না, আই থিঙ্ক শি টাচড অন দ্যাট। ডক্টর এম ডি খায়রুজ্জামান মজুমদার ফ্রম দি ফাইন্যান্স ডিভিশন টকড অ্যাবাউট দি ইম্প্যাক্ট অফ দি লেদার ইন্ডাস্ট্রি গোয়িং ডাউন বাই 27%, কারেন্সি ওয়ার বা ট্যারিফের জন্য যে কারেন্সি ডিভ্যালুয়েশন করছে চায়না সেটার কথা উনি বলেছেন। MD Dr. Muhammad Abu Yusuf, Deputy Secretary, he highlighted why Vietnam is getting higher than Bangladesh, the impact on this and implementation. He stressed on the need of for implementation. Skills development, GDP, FDI, mone hoy apne 40%, I think it should be 4%. 40% to GDP, I think CEO can respond to that. 40% of, I'll come back to you. Abdul Salam, former SVP, talked about promotion activity. That also I am talking in my speech. I did mention that promotion activity. For that, we need a committee. We need a task force, engagement of the private sector. Without the private sector, if you go and promote, I think that promotion would not have bigger impact. Mr. Enamul Haq Patwari talked about jute, the impact of jute and impact of devaluation. He put forward a question to our chief guest and the keynote presenter on their views of impact on devaluation with taka. Khairam Khan talked about green industry, FDI, and also I think he touched on the promotion of Bangladesh and the product line. Abdul Salam, DGM from Agrani Bank, right? Bank Asia. So, impact on RMG, impact of J. And Mr. Tapan Kanti Ghosh, I think he pointed out a very important point on the special economic zone, labor laws and others, if these are not compliant as per the international buyers or international companies, then how do we address this issue? Relocation of China and the China Plus One strategy, I think he also touched upon. I would sum up by saying that the government is trying hard and the economic moment of Bangladesh gives us a lot of hope. The war between the big boys, there are some spillover effects. And how do you grab those spillover effects? So big tigers fighting for the meat and the small tiger goes and gets the good meat. So if that is the case, I think we are not doing our homework right. We need to really concentrate, brainstorm. I think these sessions should become workshops. You know, you target, you have small cluster groups from the private sector, from the EPB, from the Ministry of Finance, from NBR, from Tariff Committee. Really do a brainstorming as to why Vietnam is getting more. We can do seminars after seminars, and you know, the world will move on. We will still do being seminars on the impact. Why didn't we get it? What happened? What went wrong? So I want to act a concentrated effort as to how government থেকে private sector is always ready. Private sector এটার সবচেয়ে ক্ষতিগ্রস্ত হবে private sector. সেখানে আমরা বলছি একটা task force গঠন করেন, সেখানে যারা ব্যবসায়ীরা আছে আমাদের বিভিন্ন চেম্বারে তাদেরকে এঙ্গেজ করেন, তাদেরকে সেই দায়িত্ব দেন, কম্পিটিটিভ অ্যানালিসিস করতে হবে, কম্পারেটিভ অ্যানালিসিস করতে হবে. তারপরে আমরা রিসার্চের জন্য ফান্ডিং চাচ্ছি, আপনারা ম্যাচিং ফান্ড দেন, আমরা যদি 10 কোটি টাকা তুলতে পারি আপনারা 10 কোটি টাকা ফান্ড দেন. রিসার্চ না করলে বাংলাদেশ এগিয়ে যাবে না, ইনোভেশন দরকার আছে. আমরা যদি বটম অফ দ্য পিরামিডে থাকি তাহলে কিন্তু আমরা ওই বটম অফ দ্য পিরামিডেই থেকে যাব. আমাদের ইনোভেশন দরকার, রিসার্চ দরকার. এটা শুধু সরকারি লেভেলে হলে হবে না, এটা প্রাইভেট সেক্টরকে এঙ্গেজ করতে হবে. ঢাকা চেম্বার অলরেডি একটা আরএনআই ইনস্টিটিউট নিয়ে চিন্তা করছে. আমাদের দুঃখের কথা হচ্ছে যে কেউ এগিয়ে আসে না ফান্ডিং করার জন্য. আমরা বলছি কমার্স মিনিস্ট্রিকে, থ্রু দি অনারেবল সিনিয়র সেক্রেটারি আছেন, আমরা 5 কোটি টাকা দিয়েছি, আপনারা 5 কোটি টাকা দেন, আমরা একটা রিসার্চ ইনোভেশন একটা দাঁড় করাই, আমরা দেখি এই রিসার্চগুলি আজকে আমরা যে এখানে কথাবার্তা বললাম এটা কী হবে. এটা সব আমরা এই ডায়েরিতে রেখে যাব বা আমাদের এটা আউটকাম রিপোর্ট হিসেবে সবার ফাইলে রেখে যাবো, কিন্তু এটার কোনো ফলো আপ হবে না. সেখানে বাংলাদেশ আই থিঙ্ক নিডস টু রিয়েলি ইমপ্লিমেন্ট. সো এই বলে আমি আই উইল হ্যান্ড ওভার টু দ্য আওয়ার কিনোট speaker if he wants to add or reply to any questions. Sir, 5 minutes, sir.
I have had the good luck of being keynote speakers in quite a few other occasions. To be a keynote speaker is not a very easy thing because you are bombarded with barrages of questions. I'm very thankful to my respected panelists and the audience. They've been very kind not to have attacked me or not to have sent barrages of questions. So I don't have much to say except this. Mr. Enamul Haq Patwari, he suggested devaluation. Devaluation is a very easy thing at the hands of the finance ministers. Previously they used to print money, but nowadays it's not that easy. They can do it in many other ways. Devaluation is very, very alluring, but very dangerous way. If you devalue your currency, you immediately see that it increases your exports, but it creates lot of inflation and price rises. It brings in more unhappiness than happiness to your country. So this has to be avoided. What we have, what we should do instead is to, your skills should be enhanced, your productivity should be increased, your competitiveness in other fields should be increased. That is the way, not inflation. Because if you inflate your currency, it is going to be wiped off very soon, and you go for further inflation. We know about what happened in Germany during the Second World War. A bottle of used wine or alcoholic drink was priced more than a million marks, more than a million, a used bottle. So inflation is a very dangerous thing. We should not take recourse to it at all. Immediately it sounds good, but it's very, very bad. One should not go for that. Others have, some have praised me, or some have said very kind words, sometimes undeservedly, but I think these were all very kind to me, and I don't have much to reply to, except relocation of industries. Sharifa Khan brought it about. Yes, we have to be very careful. We just should not allow anyone and any type of industry. We must be scrutinizing what is proposed to come here. Dr. Khairujjaman Mazumdar, I cannot name many, he has brought in some very good aspects. The leather sector has come into discussion. In fact, I said that what I have tried to do in this slide presentation is touching on the thing so that the very enlightened and informed discussion follows, which it did. And I'm very grateful to my learned panelists, to the respected chair, and to other participants here. I don't say much except that I thank you very heartily for sparing me the pains of answering unanswerable questions. Thank you very, very much. We tried to be brief, but tried to be all-encompassing to start a national, if possible, or a business-wise discussion, because trade war is now being talked about everything, and I must thank, I did forget it the first time, I must thank the DCCI, Dhaka Chamber of Commerce and Industry, and especially its very dynamic chairman and his assistants for organizing such a timely discussion meeting, a seminar. I personally feel thankful, and BFTI also thanks, and we believe that in future we will also, even if you are not as chairman of the DCCI forever, which you will not be, we will continue discussions. And he has also referred to some researchers. We do have our moderate works in researchers, some of which may be seen in our website. We will continue to do that with your blessings. He is also an honorable member on the board of directors, ex officio. So we thank all of you, ladies and gentlemen, for giving us a kind, this is not the end of the meeting, there are chief guests, special guests, but from my side, a great thank you for your kindness and for your compassion and for your very kind appreciation of the modest presentation that we have made. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, may I now request the special guest, Mr. Bijay Bhattacharji, Vice Chairman, Export Promotion Bureau, EPB, to kindly deliver his speech.
Mr. Senior Secretary, Ministry of Commerce, Mr. President, DCCI, Chief Executive Officer, BFTI, and all my distinguished colleagues and the distinguished business people herein. Just after assuming the power, Donald Trump, as required by US Trade Act 1974, declared some policy objectives for the trade. And this trade friction, I will not term it as a war. This is a blown up word by the media. Trade friction was inevitable, and we are a little bit late. Many countries or many trading nations were closely following that development. And I just read out two main points of his trade policy agenda 2018 that will clear what is going to happen and what further he is going to do. Two agendas. One is aggressive enforcement of US trade laws. That means he is going to enforce the US trade laws wherever possible, which were not aggressively or normally imposed in the earlier time. The second, and reforming the multilateral trading system. These are two main agenda, trade policy agenda of Mr. Trump, of this Republican government. So we have to closely follow. There will happen many, many things, and we can expect something from the next G20 meeting, which is going to be held in Buenos Aires on the last week of this November. Let us follow the development. The second thing, we are expecting much from the Chinese. Here there are some very distinguished business people here. Chinese has a different business model from the rest of the world. They establish a metropolitan factory in the China mainland, and they operate with a small factory on the other countries. They have a very distinct business model. It is not like US multinationals or other things. They do not appoint franchisee or any other things. They move with the small satellite investment from country to country. Here we have a good news. On 5th of October, European Union has officially notified Cambodia for withdrawing the GSP status. So we can expect many orders which will be diverted to Bangladesh. And again, we have to compare apple with apple, not apple with mango. What China produces, we do not produce. And still, US imposed certain tariffs on certain products of steel and aluminium, not all. And please go through the list of the tariff, list of the product. We do not produce anything of this, and we are not actually consumer of these things. These are high-tech things and used by American manufacturing industries. And again, if we go through the 17th September 2018 tariff list, that means USA, what USA imposed on the Chinese product, you will surprisingly find that no mention of chapter 61 to 64. Chapter 61, neat, no oven, no headgear, no shoes. It is because this has been done or suggested after a kind of research work through the ITC, and ITC provided the facility to speak out the businessmen, and the US business people suggested that this should not be done because no other country has the capacity to absorb this, otherwise we will be suffering. So there is a question of give and take, and it is a question of advantage. I am very much appreciative of one point made by Mr. Chair. Are we ready? Have we the capacity to absorb and manage all the big investment from China? For instance, if anyone wants to establish a big petrochemical industry in Bangladesh, do we have manpower, efficient manpower and managerial skill to manage this? Otherwise this will not come. And why? In 1979, US and the European companies started to move their production bases to China because it is still a big market, was a big market, and had market access and had the necessary supportive structure, soft infrastructure as well as hard infrastructure as well as human side in China to operate these factories. We have to get ourselves ready before to invite or to absorb these things. Otherwise, low-end factories will come. And do we expect that all sunset industries will come to Bangladesh just like the reconditioned cars? I am strongly against these things. We want future industries. And why USA has imposed the tariff? Or has been taking the retaliatory matters against the China? It is due to 10 future industries, 10 listed 10 in Made in China 2025 policy, 10 future industries. They are the most advantageous things. And we have to have a, even if we get a small slice of that pie, we will be happy to have that. Business means business with the future. And business with the present means it will be over by tomorrow. And China is going to transform itself to a business place or to do business in with the future. And that's why the USA is challenging. And the days, old days of England, America rivalry is again we are seeing between China and USA. And again, trade has two pillars. One is exchange rate, one is the price. This will move and come to a point of balance. And this time, it is not 1930, not fixed exchange rate. Now it is floating exchange rate. This will actually adjust and offset the tariff impact on the goods of China, even of the USA. But it will take some time. It will, and last but not the least, USA is following a policy which is called shock and awe in military doctrine, but in very general sense it is first intimidate then negotiate, and USA is doing that and will be doing that in future, first intimidate and then negotiate, because it has the big hammer and it is the biggest voracious market. There is no other voracious market on the world like the US. Thank you for inviting me and thank you for giving me the opportunity to speak out a few things. But I believe this is a very good occasion and it can be a starting point. We should sit together to further the ideas and hammer our brain, not storm, hammer our brain to find out what we can do. And we need to see the development from a holistic point of view, not only trade. And you will find a very good writing of Joseph Stiglitz. He has particularly pointed to the trade, that USA will not win in the trade war. But this is not a trade war. This is something, an economic war. And it is the shaping of the Chinese economy. USA and the European Union is trying to shape the future Chinese economy to their favor. Or at least they are trying to keep the Chinese economy so much so that help them. And last one thing. A matter of caution. On, I am just quoting. Global scenario is changing. We have to change ourselves with the changes, otherwise we will be victim of change. And Cecilia Malmström, the European Trade Commissioner, in UNCTAD told that they are considering to provide the GSP on the basis of capacity and ability. They are not in favor of providing GSP to all countries. They have already taken it to the academic domain. This will be debated for a few years in academic domain and will create a normative ground, and then it will come to the international treaty laws. This is how the things entered into the international treaty laws. And this was the original position of USA, and Cecilia Malmström has joined that. So we have to be mindful of that. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, may I now take the opportunity to request the chief guest, Mr. Shubhashish Bose, Senior Secretary, Ministry of Commerce, Government of the People's Republic of Bangladesh, to kindly deliver his speech.
Respected Chair, Mr. Abul Qasim Khan, the Vice Chairman of the Export Promotion Bureau, the presenter, Mr. Ali Ahmed, Chief Executive Officer of BFTI, the panelists present here, and senior colleagues of the Ministry of Commerce and other ministries and divisions of the Government of Bangladesh, and very esteemed participants from various
sectors of the economy of Bangladesh. Very good afternoon to you all. It's my great pleasure and honor to be here amongst you as the chief guest of this occasion. It was a timely step taken by the DCCI and BFTI to organize such an important seminar. And you can very well understand the subject matter of this seminar, which is very important for us. But one question is that whether the trade war will last for a long period or not. One of the Director Generals of the WTO, who is from China, has said that this is a matter of uncertainty and tension, and we have to address it very urgently. And I believe that USA has got one very important event to organize. Neither the president or his party want to see economic instability or job losses right before the 218 midterm election. So we can understand that the situation will definitely cool down. It will not remain as it is now, but of course this is a stunt because President Trump committed something to the sections of his society who actually supported his presidentship. Why it has happened? That's the question. Because the Trump administration actually initiated these tariffs after concluding an investigation into some of the China's most controversial trade practices. The US's new trade barriers are designed to penalize China for doing things like forcing foreign businesses to hand over their most prized technologies to Chinese companies. Most of them are actually owned by state, that means state-owned Chinese companies, in exchange of access to their market. This is a measure of penalizing Chinese companies or the government of China. But what happens to the US companies which are located in China at this point of time? These US tariffs are prompting companies to move some production out of China, but it's not going to the US. The trade war has made more than $250 billion of China's exports more expensive for American buyers. From leather belts to refrigerators to motorcycles, etc. But the companies are not flocking to the United States. Rather, they are looking to transfer their work to the Asian countries, especially to Vietnam, Cambodia, Thailand, Myanmar, etc. In a recent study conducted by the two American Chambers of Commerce in China, one-third of the companies who responded said that they were looking to switch to production out of China as a result of the trade war, but only 6% of them, they were considering moving their business back to the United States. So it means that one-third of the respondents
And out of the one-third respondents, 94% were not willing to move their business to the US, rather to other countries in Asia. In some industries, the tariffs have accelerated the shift of manufacturing from China to countries in Southeast Asia, where labor is cheaper. Many of the products US firms export from China have to fit exact requirements, necessitating specialized equipments and highly trained workers. The supply chain cannot be adjusted in short order. China also boasts better roads, ports, power grids than most of other South Asian countries. So what would happen? It's not very easy to move the industries from China or relocate the industries from China to other countries of the world. And I believe whatever has been said about the benefits that we can reap out of this problem or crisis, yes, we have to get ourselves prepared with the infrastructural facilities. We have provided facilities to various prospective investors of the world, but it has to be done in a hurry. If we can get ourselves prepared within a short span of time, definitely we can reap some of the benefits, but otherwise we will be lagging behind. That's the problem. And other countries, like India, of course, they can be benefited to a greater extent than Bangladesh. But Bangladesh is also taking some other steps in order to ease the business, because you can now open the letter of credit on the basis of yuan. That has been approved by the Bangladesh Bank, and that will facilitate the business. That's a good sign for the business community of Bangladesh. It has also been said that our position in the index of ease of doing business, we are ranking the 176th position of the world out of 90 countries. But we have got better positions in other areas. Say, for example, with respect to the International Brand Index, Brand Finance Index, we are ranking the 49th position in the world. And we are 5 notches up now. It has also been said about the investment in research and analysis. Of course, that is very much needed by the country. And I believe the Chamber of Commerce, especially the Dhaka Chamber of Commerce, being a very old chamber, should set up a cell for trade analysis and research, etc. And I think government has also provided some benefits, because if you contribute to the research and development of a particular company, they can gain some tax benefits. That is also possible. And you can urge the government from your side to allow more allowance to be accepted by the taxation department of the country, so that you can devote a good source of fund in your invest in your research analysis. We are sometimes taking the skills of other people, that is the people of various universities of the world, in trade analysis, etc. Even for our LDC graduation, we are going to engage one professor from a British university, because they had studied in Vietnam after their graduation. So we would like to engage them for our steps which we can take afterwards, that is after our graduation. If you have some kind of research facilities here, definitely you can advise the government in formulating the policies. That is of the utmost importance to the government of Bangladesh. It has also been said about the electronic sector of the country, whether Bangladesh would be able to attract relocation of industries from China in the electronic sector. If you look at the Vietnam scenario, who are the investors in that sector? Especially, they are from South Korea. They have invested in the electronic sector. They are also from Japan. So they have got capital. They have got infrastructural facilities. They have got capacities, technical capacities, etc. But these are absent in Bangladesh. We have set up some of the industrial zones here. BABSA has set up 8 industrial zones, and BABSA is also going to set up 100 economic zones in the country, but we have to target foreign direct investment, as has been said by the keynote speaker. It means that our capability is not sufficient enough to attract all the sectors of the global economy. Not possible, because we are actually used to labor intensive industries. But industrial revolution is ahead of us. We need to invest in robotics, artificial intelligence, etc. So we need foreign direct investment in those areas. You see, in our country, there are some shifts in the production process. Nowadays, we are also introducing highly sophisticated machineries, even in the garment sector. In the leather sector, we are not only confined to production of products as per specifications given by the international buyers. We are also now offering designs to the international buyers. And the buyers can choose some of the designs, and we can manufacture the products according to the designs. It's a shift in the policy of the manufacturing concerns in Bangladesh. So the government has taken a policy for setting up design centers in the country. We have got a policy with respect to leather and leather products. We have got a policy with respect to API and pharmaceutical products. We have also got a policy with respect to agro-processing products. So government is trying its level best in order to attract the foreign direct investment. And I believe that the public sector and private sector, they are going hand in hand in attracting the foreign direct investment in order to ease doing business in Bangladesh. And you have already heard that we are also moving to technology-based industries in Bangladesh in garment, ready-made garment sector, because we are just going to high-end products in the garment sector. Not only basic garments are being made in Bangladesh, but there is also a diversification in the garment products. Like denim products are being made in Bangladesh, even denim fabrics are going to other countries of the world, especially to the European Union countries and the USA. And very fashion garments are also in the process of being manufactured in Bangladesh by some of the Japanese companies and Taiwanese companies. And I also believe that in the very near future, the Bangladesh industrial sector would be able to offer many backward linkage industries in the country, which will cater to the needs of the original companies, that is the principal manufacturing products of various countries of the world. Thailand, you see, there are so many companies which are producing intermediate products. those companies has, have actually taken some steps to relocate to other countries of the world because of the rise of production in those countries. Thailand has to source the laborers from other countries, especially from Laos and Myanmar, because they do not have sufficient number of workers in the manufacturing sectors in that country. So Bangladesh has got that sort of benefit, which can provide supply of laborers all over the country, wherever the industry is set up. And the devaluation of the dollar, as has been said by our keynote speaker, that is also a very risky job for the government of Bangladesh, because if we devalue our taka against dollar, what will happen to the economy of the country? Yes, inflation would be there, and also the cost of production will rise because of the rise in the importation cost of the raw materials. So if we look at the trade figures, our imports are definitely higher than exports. We do not have raw materials in our country. We have to depend on importation of raw materials from other countries. So it would be a risky job for the government to devalue taka against US dollar. That has to be taken into account. But what has been said by our vice chairman of the Export Promotion Bureau, the productivity has to be increased. And if we can increase the productivity, definitely cost of production will go down. So that should be the step which should be taken by the various sectors of the economy. And another point I would like to mention, whether the government of Bangladesh can provide you some facilities with regard to importation of cotton. The cotton price, as the international price is now going down, it is a benefit for Bangladeshi importers that they can buy it at a cheaper price. But another point is that India has actually increased the price of cotton because of the demand that has risen in China. So there is an option by the importers that they can go for importation of cotton from the US market. But there is a problem, there is a non-tariff barrier that has been imposed on the importation of cotton from the US market, which is double fumigation. We are not importing cotton from the US without double fumigation. That is a non-tariff barrier that has been imposed on the US cotton. It is because of environmental problem, or there is a chance of growing bacteria in the cotton while in transportation, because transportation actually needs 30 days time to release the bales from US cotton in the Chittagong port. So there is a possibility of growing weevil, cotton weevil, which is very dangerous for our country. It's a pest. So double fumigation is actually necessary for importation of cotton from the US market, although it will be cheaper, but there would be a risk. But we have negotiated with the US respective department of the US, that is the agricultural ministry of the US government, whether they can certify that the cotton is actually free from that kind of weevil. So they have agreed to our proposal that they will try to certify each bale of cotton that this is free from weevil. So if it is so, then you can avail of the benefit. And finally, I would like to say that this uncertainty and tension will not last long. But we have seen that there is an increase in the garment exports from Bangladesh to the global market. This might be temporary. 20% growth will not last. But what we can do, if we can attract foreign direct investment in Bangladesh, once relocation takes place, once an industry comes to this country, definitely they will not move back soon. So there is a chance that the
factory or company which will be relocated to Bangladesh during this period, definitely they will try to stay here. That's the benefit we can reap out of this trade war. So I am very thankful to the Dhaka Chamber of Commerce and BFTI for organizing this event. This is the initiation of the seminar on this particular topic, and I believe there will be a lot of discussions on other seminars, and your suggestions, recommendations, etc. would be considered by the government of Bangladesh in formulating the policies. Once again, I thank you very much for inviting me to be here as the chief guest of this seminar, and I hope that definitely all the participants here, both from the public sector and private sector, would be immensely benefited out of this seminar. Thank you very much once again.
Thank you, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, we have come to the end of today's program. Now, I would like to request Mr. Kamrul Islam FCA, Senior Vice President DCCI, to deliver his vote of thanks.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of Dhaka Chamber of Commerce and Industry, I would like to express my thanks and gratitude to the chief guest of today's program, Mr. Subhashish Bose, Senior Secretary, Ministry of Commerce, Government of People's Republic of Bangladesh. I would also like to take the privilege to extend thanks to a special guest of today's program, Mr. Bijoy Bhattacharya, Vice Chairman, Export Promotion Bureau. I would also like to extend thanks to the Honorable Moderator, Keynote Speaker, and Distinguished Panel Discussants for their valued remarks. Distinguished guests, it is needless to say how trade war is creating concern around the globe. I believe this seminar on the trade war and implication for Bangladesh will definitely help to identify the major implication of trade war on Bangladesh economy and to prepare well for leveraging the opportunities emerge from it. Distinguished guests, before wrapping up, once again, I express my heartfelt thanks to all of you to be with us and make this seminar a successful one. Allah Hafiz. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for being with us. I humbly request you to join us for lunch at DCCI Business Lounge next door. Thank you once again.